Welcome back to Chemistry Matters, Unit 7, Solutions, Acids, and Bases. By now, you should have completed the solubility lab with salts. As you saw near the end of the last video on our playlist, our students were discovering that not all substances dissolve in water, even when the students stirred the mixture and increased the temperature. And if you performed this lab correctly, you should have gotten similar results. Chemists have a word that describes this phenomenon, insoluble. Insoluble means that a solid, liquid, or gas will not dissolve in a particular solvent. Solubility depends on the attractions between the solute and the solvent. For example, when sodium chloride, or common table salt, is added to water, the sodium and chloride ions are more attracted to the water than they are to each other. But as our students saw in the solubility lab, calcium and sulfate ions are more attracted to each other than they are to the water. Some other examples of insoluble substances are salt in gasoline or copper in water. If copper could dissolve in water, the Statue of Liberty would have disappeared into New York Harbor long ago. Soluble, on the other hand, means that a solid, liquid, or gas can be dissolved in a particular solvent. Solubility is a term that describes the maximum amount of a substance that can be dissolved in a given quantity of solvent at a given temperature to produce a saturated solution. Now, we just used a new term there, saturated solution. So let's look at what that means. A saturated solution is a solution in which the maximum amount of solute has been dissolved in a given amount of a solvent at a particular temperature. For example, let's say you're trying to make some sweet tea, and you've already brewed the tea by pouring very hot water over the tea bags to get your unsweet tea. Now, you want to add sugar, so you start adding sugar one spoonful at a time. At first, you'll notice that most of the sugar dissolves almost immediately. That's because the solution can hold more sugar at that temperature. But as you continue to add sugar, you'll eventually reach a point where you can no longer dissolve any more sugar into the tea at that temperature, regardless of how much you stir. This is called the saturation point, which is where you can no longer dissolve any more solute in that solution at that temperature. With that in mind, let's head back to our classroom, where our students are in the process of investigating how temperature can affect the solubility of three different salts.
Okay, let's look at your data. Tell me what you found.
Well, we found different results for each of the salts.
Yeah, the calcium sulfate didn't dissolve at any temperature.
The potassium nitrate dissolved completely at 30 degrees Celsius, but only some of it dissolved at 5 degrees.
How about your team? Did you get similar results for the calcium sulfate and potassium nitrate?
Yep, pretty much the same results.
What about the sodium chloride? How soluble was it?
The sodium chloride completely dissolved, even at the lowest temperature.
Very good. And I like the terminology you're using to describe your data. For soluble substances like potassium nitrate and sodium chloride, temperature does indeed play a role. As a matter of fact, we say that solubility is temperature dependent, because in most cases, the higher the temperature of the solvent, the greater the amount of solute can be held. Take a look at these graphs. They're called solubility curves, and they show the temperature dependence on the solubility of both the potassium nitrate and the sodium chloride. Maria and Cade, as you interpret this graph, can you explain your observations with respect to sodium chloride?
Yeah, I think I can. According to the graph, it looks like we could have dissolved almost 40 grams of sodium chloride in our beaker that was at 5 degrees Celsius. I guess that's why all 25 grams completely dissolved, even at that low of a temperature.
It looks like the solubility of sodium chloride only goes up a little bit, though, as the temperature is increased.
Very good, both of you. Kat and Josh, what about the potassium nitrate you investigated? Does your data support what's displayed here?
I believe so. We noticed when we tried to dissolve the 25 grams of potassium nitrate at 5 degrees Celsius, it looked like only a little bit of it dissolved.
Yeah, and looking at the graph, I can see why. If we have 100 grams of water at 5 degrees Celsius, it looks like we can only dissolve around 18 grams of potassium nitrate. No wonder some of it wouldn't dissolve.
Right, but look at how much the temperature affects the solubility of potassium nitrate. I can see why all of it dissolved when the water was 30 degrees Celsius. It looks like we could have dissolved around 45 grams of potassium nitrate at that temperature.
Exactly right. You've all done a very nice job of interpreting the data on this graph. And now you can apply this type of thinking to other graphs too.
It looks like our students are getting a handle on how to interpret solubility curves. But let's explore solubility curves a little more closely. A solubility curve shows the dependence of solubility on temperature. On this graph from our classroom, which depicts the solubility of sodium chloride and potassium nitrate, the y-axis shows grams of solute per 100 grams of water, and the x-axis displays temperature in degrees Celsius. As you know, sodium chloride and potassium nitrate are solids, but other solids dissolve in water too, like sodium nitrate, NaNO3, potassium chloride, KCl, ammonium chloride, NH4Cl, and potassium iodide, Ki. One thing you'll notice is that for solids, which are represented on the graph as solid lines, as temperature increases, greater and greater amounts of solute can be dissolved in that 100 grams of water. But gases such as ammonia, NH3, will also dissolve in water. So will sulfur dioxide, SO2, and hydrogen chloride, HCl. For gases, which are indicated with dashed lines, the greater the temperature, the less soluble they are. This pattern, which is a great example of our pattern's cross-cutting concept, is the opposite of what we see with solids. And that's why most people like their soft drinks to be cold. They're more bubbly that way. You'll notice that calcium sulfate is not on the graph. You might be wondering why that is. Let's go back to our classroom and find out what our students think.
I have a question about the calcium sulfate. I know it didn't dissolve, but does that mean it doesn't have a solubility curve?
That's an outstanding question. We can generate a solubility curve for calcium sulfate, but because it's essentially insoluble, we'd need to drastically change our units on our axes to be able to visualize it. Only about 0.21 grams of calcium sulfate will dissolve in 100 grams of water when its temperature is about 20 degrees Celsius.
Whoa, and we tried to dissolve 25 grams. No wonder it just floated around the top of the beaker.
Yes, it doesn't take very much calcium sulfate to dissolve at all for the solution to become saturated. Occasionally, if a saturated solution is allowed to slowly cool, you can get what's called a supersaturated solution. This is a solution that's holding more dissolved solute than it would normally hold at that temperature. The reason I've asked you to wear your safety glasses is because in these flasks, I have aqueous solutions of sodium acetate trihydrate that were heated above 70 degrees Celsius and saturated at that temperature. I then allowed them to cool overnight. When we arrived here today, they're considered a supersaturated solution, and it's very unstable. In fact, all it would take for all of that solute to come out of the solution and to crystallize is a single sodium acetate crystal. So what I've done is placed a few sodium acetate crystals on the watch glass in front of you, and I'm going to ask you to slowly pour your supersaturated solutions onto the watch glass. Go ahead.
Whoa.
Yeah, that's crazy. That's
like
awesome.
Ice. Man, this is so awesome.
It's snow. And see, yeah,
can it get taller?
All the ones are sitting on top.
Let's see.
It's already like completely full.
It looks like it's gonna fall.
It's like
this
snow.
Is so
you got
cool.
Some more. This is so cool.
This is so awesome.
That gained height really quickly.
I think
Science.
Ours is taller.
There we go.
Wow, that was a pretty clever demonstration of a solution that was holding too much solute at a particular temperature. The process we just observed is called crystallization. Lots of supersaturated solutions will crystallize when their conditions change, but they won't always do it in such a dramatic fashion. Not only can solutes be thought of as making a solution saturated or even supersaturated, they can also be classified as non-electrolytes, weak electrolytes, or strong electrolytes. Now, I'm sure you've seen commercials for sports drinks touting their ability to replenish electrolytes lost while sweating. But what exactly are electrolytes? Well, in the simplest sense, electrolytes are ions, or charged particles. Some solutes, when dissolved, actually produce a lot of ions. Solutes, like ionic compounds or even strong acids, are known as strong electrolytes for their ability to produce these ions in solutions. Solutes, such as weak acids, produce very few ions in solutions and are therefore known as weak electrolytes. And covalently bonded substances, such as table sugar, don't produce any ions at all when they dissolve. They're known as non-electrolytes. Why the term electrolyte, though? Let's head back to the classroom for another shocking demonstration.
What I have here is a light bulb, with one electrode connected to this wire and the other electrode connected to the other. For safety reasons, I'm only going to plug it in once this is in the solution. When the circuit is completed and electrons can flow, electricity will pass from one electrode to the other, and the light bulb will light up. For the electricity, the moving electrons, to make it from one electrode to the other, there must be charged particles in the solution. It's kind of like a frog trying to make it from one end of the pond to another, jumping on logs and lily pads. The electrons must move from ion to ion throughout the solution. There have to be ions in the solution for the current to flow. The more ions, the more current can flow. The solvent here is distilled water, which has no ions in it. See? No light. Now we're going to test some solutions. First, I'm going to dissolve some sugar into the distilled water. And nothing happens. No light because there are no ions. We can characterize sugar as a non-electrolyte. Now I'm going to place some sodium chloride, or common table salt, and then stir it up to dissolve it. Voila.
Oh, so ions must have formed. That makes sense because sodium chloride is an ionic compound.
Yeah, and I can see bubbling in there too.
Yes, what you're seeing is electrolysis, or the decomposition of water. Just like we saw in Unit 5 when we studied chemical reactions. The fact that the electrons can make it from one electrode to the other indicates that there are ions in the salt water solution and that electricity is causing the water to decompose into hydrogen and oxygen gases. That's why sodium chloride, along with most ionic compounds, is known as a strong electrolyte. When dissolved, strong electrolytes allow current to be passed through them. Lastly, I have some acetic acid here, which is known as a weak electrolyte. You'll notice that there's only going to be a faint glow of the light because there's a relatively small amount of ions in the solution.
You said most ionic compounds are strong electrolytes, but what about the calcium sulfate we looked at earlier? That wouldn't be a strong electrolyte, right? I mean, it didn't really dissolve at all.
It's a great question and observation, and you're exactly right. Calcium sulfate won't fit our definition of a strong electrolyte since it didn't produce a large number of ions in the solution.
So how come certain solutes dissolve while others don't?
Well, there are several factors involved, but one that we studied back in Unit 4 has to do with the shape and the polarity of the solute and solvent and their attraction to each other. Remember, polar substances have areas of slightly positive and slightly negative charges where the electrons are unequally shared. And there are attractive forces between these slightly positive and slightly negative charged areas and the particles with opposite charges. When solutes and solvents have similar intermolecular forces, the forces between the particles, the solute is much more likely to be soluble in the solvent. Therefore, a polar or ionic solute is usually soluble in a polar solvent, and a nonpolar solute would be soluble in a nonpolar solvent. But you asked about calcium sulfate, which is ionic and is not soluble in water, which is polar. Remember that soluble ionic compounds separate into ions when they dissolve. They do that because the ions are more attracted to the solvent than they are to each other. In the case of calcium sulfate in water, most of the calcium ions and the sulfate ions are more attracted to each other than they are to the water. That's why they don't dissolve.
Our teacher was just making a very important point, and it's related to a saying you might have heard. Like dissolves like. Have you ever gotten oil or something greasy on your hands and you couldn't get it off with just water? Water is polar, while grease is nonpolar. Soap or detergent, like I have in this Erlenmeyer flask, is a great example of like dissolving like. Soap is both polar, like water, and nonpolar, like grease. The soap molecule has a polar head with a long nonpolar tail. The nonpolar part of the soap molecule sticks to the grease and dirt, while the polar head of the molecule sticks to the water. So when you wash your hands with soap, the dirt and grease are removed from your skin and go down the sink with the water when you rinse your hands. Now that we have a fundamental understanding of what solutions are and how they form, we're ready to more closely explore the composition of solutions. So next, we're going to learn how to express the concentration of solutions, which is another way of describing how much solute is present in the solution. And we'll do that at the top of the next video on the playlist. I'll see you there.